They say that you can be frozen by being frightened. And I think my brain was cut off. Nameless dread is the word that I think of.
Christine Enmark is recalling the most terrifying time in her life.
The next thing I remember is that I'm sitting tied up on a chair. This criminal was so extremely nervous. At that time, I think I couldn't really understand that this was happening.
It's the summer of 1973, and she's a hostage in a bank robbery. The robber, Jana, wants to show the police that he means business. So he turns to one of the other hostages, Sven.
And Jana said he was going to shoot him in the leg. I'm not going to hurt any bones. It's not going to make so much injury. And Sven was scared.
At that crucial moment, Christine says something odd.
And then I said to Sven, but Sven, it's only in the leg.
It's only in the leg. Why would Christine say this? Who on earth sides with a dangerous criminal when their life is on the line? My name's Matthew Side. Welcome to Sideways, my show exploring the ideas that shape our lives with stories of seeing the world differently. This episode, we're focusing on a psychiatric condition that was born in a bank robbery and over the last half century has taken on a life of its own. It's a theory that has come to influence the very way we think of oppression and violence. And it's a story about victimhood, about power, and who gets to determine what is and what isn't a psychiatric condition. It's August 1973, a sunny day in Sweden. 23-year-old Christine Enmark, a stenographer at one of Stockholm's largest banks, the Kreditbanken, has just finished typing a letter.
From the beginning, it was an ordinary day, of course. I went to work as usual, and then I had some things to do in the big bank hall.
While she's there, a man walks in. He's wearing a pair of fake glasses and a thick brown wig. From under his jacket, he pulls out a machine gun.
Suddenly, I heard some shots, and I lay down on the floor. The robber man came behind the desk and pointed out me and two of my colleagues to stand up.
The man's name is Jana Olsen, a 32-year-old safecracker and explosives expert. He's just escaped prison, but this isn't a smash and grab gone wrong. His plan is to use the hostages as leverage to escape Sweden and prison for good.
And he said that he wanted 3 million Swedish crowns, and he wanted a car, and he wanted another criminal who was in jail to be taken to the back.
Christine hears the name of the man he's asking for, Clark Olafsson.
I thought this is going to be hell.
Because Christine, like almost everyone else in Sweden, knows that name.
He was described as extremely dangerous.
26, handsome, Clark Olofsson is one of Sweden's most famous criminals. A bank robber, he's already escaped from prison twice. Amazingly, the chief negotiator, a psychologist called Dr. Niels Berroth, agrees. The police bring Clark Olofsson from his cell and let him go into the bank. The bank robbers take the hostages and hole up in the ground floor of the bank in the safety deposit vault, out of sight of police snipers. The negotiators agree to the other terms too. They give Olsen his money. They park a getaway car outside, a blue Mustang. There's just one more request. Jana wants to bring some of the hostages with him in the getaway car. The police say no. The door to the vault slams shut. A policeman has crept down the stairs and closed the entrance to the outer chamber. Yana, Clark, and the hostages are trapped inside. It's the police who are in charge. Inside, Yana Olsen sits one of the hostages on a chair facing the door and ties a bomb to her foot. Then he turns off the lights. They sit in darkness and wait. The only sound is Yana chewing caffeine tablets. As time goes by, Yana starts to get more and more jumpy. He needs to show the police that he's serious. He's going to have to shoot Sven. Not kill him, mind. Just shoot him in the leg. This is when Christine starts to exhibit the odd behavior that will be discussed and debated for the next 50 years.
I really feel ashamed about this. It's not me. It's only in the leg. You're going to be shot. I think it took me 10 years to tell anybody this.
The others manage to calm Yana down. Shooting Sven won't help anyone. That's when Christine makes another decision that raises eyebrows. She calls the Swedish Prime Minister.
My name is Christine Enmark. I'm sitting as a hostage at Norrmalmstorg and I want to talk to Olof Palme. His secretary said, wait a moment. And then he comes up.
Hallå.
Hallå, ja.
Ja, det här var Christine Enmark. Hej. Det är som sitter som gisslan här i Kristina.
If a conversation between a hostage and prime minister sounds surreal, the world would later become even more astonished at what she says to him. She speaks warmly about her captors. She says she trusts them, not the police. The prime minister is taken aback. He even sounds offended.
And I tried everything to persuade him to tell the police that the police would let Jan and Clark and two of us to go with them in a car.
The prime minister tells her that it's impossible. He tells her to get the robbers to put down their weapons. She says that they won't do that. They go back and forth like this for quite a while. Then, exasperated, the Swedish Prime Minister says something truly remarkable. You can't hear it because it was removed from the recording soon after. But he says to the 23-year-old bank clerk, well, then you might just have to die at your post. Christine hangs up in despair. The siege continues for 6 more days. Eventually, the officers gain the upper hand. They ready themselves to storm the vault. With guns trained on the opening, the police shout for the hostages to come out first.
And then Janne said, if you go out first, they're going to kill us. So we said, okay, you go first.
Pause for a moment to consider the significance of this. The hostages agree to protect the very men who have kept them captive and threatened their lives. The two robbers, Yana and Clark, come out first. They stop in the doorway to embrace the hostages. Kisses for the women, a handshake for Sven. As Christine comes out, the police try and put her on a stretcher. She refuses. The police insist. She appears to be more angry at the police than at the criminals. In an interview a few days later, the chief negotiator for the police, Dr. Niels Bierot, explains to the world why Christine has acted this way. She has, he says, a psychiatric syndrome that has caused her irrational behavior. And Stockholm syndrome is born.
This is a situation in which, out of the blue, an otherwise normal person is held hostage by a criminal who has the power to kill them.
This is Frank Ockberg, a psychologist who became a world-renowned expert in Stockholm syndrome during the 1970s. He's explaining to Australia's ABC News how the syndrome develops in traumatic situations.
And within a matter of hours, the hostage is treated like an infant and has a kind of regression to infantile emotions. They can't eat, they can't talk, they can't use a toilet without permission. To do it risks death. And they accept the feeling that this is the giver of life, just like my mother was.
But it is 2 years after Christine Enmark that the syndrome really breaks cover. An American heiress, Patty Hearst, is kidnapped in California by a revolutionary organization called the Symbionese Liberation Army. Held captive for months, she ends up helping them in a bank robbery. In court, her lawyers use Stockholm Syndrome to defend her. From then on, almost any kidnapping and Stockholm Syndrome is mentioned. Christine Enmark's experience has become the lens to examine hostage situations. And this phenomenon has consequences that will come to reverberate across social science.
Christine is one of the most famous and one of the least understood women in psychology. My name's Alan Wade. I'm a family therapist, psychologist, researcher with a primary interest in addressing violence. Christine knows that Stockholm Syndrome is a big idea, but I don't think she knew exactly how big outside of Sweden.
And how did you get interested in the concept of Stockholm Syndrome?
Well, I've been working with people who've been victimized and people who've committed violence for many years. I suppose it's one of a family of related concepts used to represent violated, oppressed people.
Let's take a closer look at that family of related concepts, because the origins of Stockholm Syndrome go further back than Christine.
Basically, it comes from several lines of thought combined by Anna Freud in a 1940 article on identification with the aggressor.
Anna Freud, founder of psychoanalytic child psychology, youngest daughter of Sigmund. Freud worked with abused children. She came to believe that a child who had been treated violently would internalize that violence. The child would come to sympathize with their aggressor. She saw this identification as a defense mechanism.
So the psychoanalytic idea was that when people are overwhelmed by fear, they unconsciously regress to an infantile state and begin to identify with their aggressor because their aggressor is the giver of life.
And there's another area where these ideas began to grow.
Related ideas can be found in some forms of Marxist thought where the proletariat, the oppressed, are said to one day rise up and confront their oppressors. The problem being that that doesn't seem to happen necessarily as often as some people would like. So then they ask the question, why not? Why don't the oppressed stand up against oppression? And that leads to the development of all kinds of psychological theories. The core idea is that the oppressed are tricked into having a false consciousness.
They have internalized the ideology of their oppressors. In each of these examples, it's the victims who are acting irrationally against their best interests. Then Stockholm Syndrome, indebted to all of these theories, begins to take on a life of its own and spread even further.
It's just often used offhand, right? Like, you know, you get people saying, oh, she must have Stockholm Syndrome.
During the 1990s, Stockholm Syndrome becomes a way to explain not just hostages or the proletariat, but why victims of domestic violence can't or won't leave their abusers. Jess Hill, author of the award-winning book, He Made Me Do It.
It just became one of those easy offhand ways to explain an incredibly complex situation, which could have multiple kaleidoscopic explanations. People would just sort of land on Stockholm Syndrome as a good little neat reason for why a woman didn't act the way that they thought that she should, with their very limited understanding of what domestic abuse is.
You've heard it before. Perhaps you've even thought it. Why doesn't she leave? What's making her stay? Some trauma experts say it's because the victim, typically a woman, has a sense of dependency on her partner.
All of us have a sense of dependency on our partners. That's not a syndrome, that's attachment. In an intimate relationship, which is entirely different even to a hostage situation with a stranger, the idea of Stockholm syndrome becomes so ludicrous. We have principles of attachment that are at play.
So a syndrome used to define what happens when a hostage forms a bond with a stranger is applied to a situation where the victim and their aggressor are in a relationship.
What it misses is where women are actually rationalizing their abuse. The sorts of things that worry them, that stop them from leaving, are there obviously the fact that leaving is the most dangerous time, that they may not be financially independent. There's a whole lot of mental gymnastics that can go on where women feel like, I don't have choices.
So Christine Enmark isn't just the woman who defined a new syndrome. She is at the epicenter of a set of connected theories about power. Stockholm syndrome gathers them together irresistibly, providing an easy catch-all buzzword. And this makes me a little suspicious. Now let's take another look at what happened in that bank almost 50 years ago and just shift our lens slightly. Is there another way of viewing Christine's story?
The options that the police had at that time were basically come out or we're going to come in and get you. And of course that led to some pretty tragic consequences with perpetrators being killed, police officers being killed, hostages being killed.
This is Gary Nessner, who recently retired as chief of the FBI's Crisis Negotiation Unit following a 30-year career. Gary's book about his life's work was the inspiration behind the TV series Waco. In 1973, when bank robber Yana Olson was plotting his elaborate escape plan, Gary was a fledgling FBI agent.
After being an agent for some years, there was a new and emerging discipline called hostage negotiations that was started by the New York City Police Department, the FBI.
A study published 2 years after the Stockholm incident calculated the risk of death to hostages in a police standoff as 79%. In the early years of kidnap situations, police made all manner of rookie errors they simply wouldn't make today. One of them, you don't let hostages or perpetrators talk to several people.
We want to be the single voice that they hear in all the interactions that we have. We don't want them shopping for a better deal.
Second, you don't give in to unrealistic demands.
If somebody wants a prisoner released or they want a huge sum of money or a getaway car, that's something that we're probably not going to give them.
Third, and this is more of a do than a don't, you have to gain the trust of perpetrators.
Well, it's absolutely critical that we as negotiators are genuine, sincere, trustworthy, likable.
And not just perpetrators, but hostages too.
Well, I don't think that anybody was sleeping because we were so scared, because we didn't know what the police was going to do. They were all the time trying to get so close to the robber as they could. I thought that maybe they are going to do something that could affect me, because the robber was getting nervous.
A day into the Stockholm hostage situation, the psychologist Niels Bierot has an idea. What if we bring a family member in to negotiate with Yana Olsen? So they fetch his brother. He goes down the stairs to the bank vault. He shouts, "Don't shoot, don't shoot, I'm your brother." Yana starts shooting. The hostages are terrified. What sort of maniac would shoot at his own brother? Only it isn't Yana Olsen's brother. Remember how Yana had entered the bank in disguise? The police thought he was someone else. They'd brought in the wrong brother. Every time the police intervened, the risk to the hostages increased, not decreased.
It is not at all uncommon for hostages to feel as though the police are potentially a threat to them. If the police, in their mind, come in with guns ablaze, are they going to be caught in a crossfire?
It's been almost a week. The hostages are still trapped in the bank. The Swedish government is aware the nation is watching. It's not a good look. So the police decide to force the matter.
This is the point where I'm extremely critical to the police. You know, they drilled in the roof. They had closed us in. And then they let in gas, as some people do when they're going to kill rats.
The plan is to release gas into the vault and knock everyone unconscious. Then come in and free the hostages. Well, that's the plan.
Janne had told us that if they're putting in gas, you might get brain damages, and I don't want that, so I'm going to kill you.
He puts nooses around the necks of Christine and the other hostages.
So when the gas came, Janne shouted, "Stand up." Maybe I'm going to begin to cry a little now. I thought that this is the end.
The lives of Christine and her fellow hostages are now hanging like a thread.
And they don't know if they can get in to get us out.
Christine did get out. She survived. Janne and Clark surrendered. But maybe not so much thanks to the police. They'd shut her in a vault. They'd released gas while she was in a noose. Even the Prime Minister had told her she may have to die at her post. The interests of the hostages and those of the police and state were misaligned. The police don't want captors to escape peacefully with their loot. Giving in to their demands would incite new attacks. The hostages, on the other hand, are much more worried about a shootout between the police and their captors. And yet, because of the way Christine Enmark acts during her 6 days of captivity, she is labelled with a psychiatric disorder. She had identified with her captors over the people who were there to save her. So what was really going on? Niels Bierot was a psychologist in charge of the police negotiations. He decided to lock them in the vault. He decided to gas them. He was also the one that said that Christine had Stockholm, or Normalstorg syndrome, as it was called at first. Psychotherapist Alan Wade.
She's been dragged out on a stretcher, and they ask, "Are you still critical of the police response?" And she said, "Yes, you know I am. It was dangerous." The person who might have felt criticized by that comment, Niels Bierot, they then spoke to him, and he said basically, "Well, you can't listen to her. She has Normalstorg syndrome." The whole notion, I think, was an accusation. It was a way to dismiss what an incredibly heroic woman had been doing for 6.5 days to resist, preserve her dignity, look after the other hostages.
The day after Christine emerged from captivity, an incredible photo was published in one of Sweden's largest daily newspapers, illustrating the scene that awaited her as she left the bank vault.
Outside, there were two men with gas masks, nude at the top. They had these guns that were cut off. I would more have liked to ordinary policemen saying, "Welcome out."
In case you missed that, two shirtless policemen, young, strapping, classically Swedish looking, with sawn off shotguns, are waiting to escort the criminals out of the bank. One set of powerful men winning over another set of gun-toting criminals. And that's why I think this story isn't just about psychological weakness, the psychological weakness, you'll note, of women. It's about gender and masculinity, of female victims fought over by men with guns, and most crucially of all, a narrative owned and controlled by men in power, the psychiatrist covering up for his mistakes. What's incredible about this entire episode is nobody bothered to ask Christine why she felt the way she did.
None of the world experts on Stockholm syndrome have ever spoken to Christine. There have been a lot of powerful white men, mostly, who've made a lot of money talking about Stockholm syndrome, talking about her without her. rather than trying to provide a voice for Christine to articulate her own experience.
Ever since, I always felt that I did something wrong. I shouldn't have said that I was afraid of the police. I shouldn't have spoken to Olof Palme like that.
She told me when it was all over, I needed somebody to hold me tight for a really, really long time and tell me that I did a really good job. That didn't happen for her. She got pathologized by people in mental health who didn't have the ethics to bother talking to her.
I can't help thinking that Stockholm Syndrome is a cliche, one with no medical basis, no body of evidence, but one that certainly fits a broader pattern. Instead of seeing the situation from the perspective of the victim, we see it as partly their fault. Hostages should trust the police, even when they've been let down by them, rather than the kidnappers. Marxists think that workers should trust the revolutionary vanguard, never the capitalists. Victims of domestic abuse should trust society to support them when they leave violent partners, even when they've been chronically let down by that very society in their past. When trust is not forthcoming, we see it not as a flaw in the system, but as a weakness of the victims. Ultimately, then, this is a story about the power of those who get to determine the explanations. And this certainly was not Christine Enmark.
It's bullshit, if you can say that in BBC. It's a way of blaming the victim. I did what I could to survive.